Everyone, Isabella Rosner here, back with my second video. So this two weeks video will be about the wax and shellwork shadow boxes I mentioned in my last video. So I'm going to start sharing my screen so you can see what I'm talking about. Last video, I mentioned that my PhD project, which is about Quaker women's art before 1800, basically started because I happened to see two of these big kind of wooden dioramas when I was working at Colonial Williamsburg. And these are the two boxes that I saw. What I didn't talk about last week is the fact that there are six of these boxes. And I'm looking at all six of them in my PhD. All six of them were made by Quaker women. We know this for a fact. They were made by Quaker women in and around the Philadelphia area between approximately 1745 and 1770. They are unlike anything else that was made in the area or in anywhere outside of colonial America. There are perhaps slightly comparable examples being made in Boston by schoolgirls, but those were being used as sconces and they involved all wax, no shells. There was maybe one example given to Martha Washington, the wife of George Washington, first president of the United States, but it was on a very different scale. There's truly nothing like this, which itself brings up a bunch of questions about how did people get this idea? Why were Quaker women making this sort of stuff? You know, why did this idea not spread beyond Philadelphia? How did these women know each other to all make these similar objects? And why did the trend end? So let's briefly talk about them. As you can see, there are six here up on the screen. The top three, so basically my PhD, I've divided them into two groups, the top three and the bottom three. The top three are vertically oriented, very shell heavy, and all made by adult women. So the first one, Rebecca Evans, was probably at least about 40 when she made her object. And as you can see, all three have these sort of idealized landscape scenes, lots of buildings. The first two clearly have the same red brick house, the same structure. They have the exact same layout, just with the stairs on the opposite side, which brings up a lot of questions about what the heck was going on, basically. It perhaps suggests that you could buy these as sort of a ready-made kit in a shop, so you could make your own shadow box. But it's hard to say that because there is no documentation that survives of anybody selling anything similar. There is almost no documentation of any sort of wax or shellwork education being undertaken in Philadelphia until at least the 1760s. So how were these two women making basically the same thing, at least 12 years apart? There is not much evidence to say they know each other. And speaking of that, I've done a lot of research to see how these women were, you know, overlapping. Were they married to different family members? Were they friends? How did they all know each other? And I can't find anything other than the fact that they all attended the same Quaker meeting. They all went to what became the Arch Street Meeting House in Philadelphia. They're all buried there as well, with the exception of Abigail Harrison, whose grave site has not been discovered yet by me or anybody else. So lots of questions, including how did these women know to make these objects? I don't know, especially because the top three objects were made by adult women rather than schoolgirls as part of some sort of education. All three women, and we know most about Anne Reckless Emlyn and Mary Sandwith. They were part of the Philadelphia Quaker elite. Rebecca Evans, her husband was a shoemaker. Anne Reckless Emlyn, her husband was a Revolutionary War figure. They actually had George Washington stay at their house. Mary Sandwith, the one top right corner, was the sister of Elizabeth Drinker, who's very famous and well-known in the field of American studies because she wrote a diary in 18th century colonial Philadelphia, and that diary survives. All of it has been, you know, transcribed and is available as printed books. She's a huge deal because she tells us so much about what it was like to be a woman in colonial Philadelphia. This was made by her unmarried sister, Mary. And interestingly, if you can see at the top of the piece, there's a little lion that lion is made out of beads. And that sort of beadwork lion was actually made in the 17th century. Nothing like that was made in the 18th century. I know that because I've looked at a lot of beadwork. I'm kind of like a beadwork pro at this point. Didn't think that would be my life, but it is. So basically, she had taken this 100 at that point year old lion to include in her shadow box, which itself asks a lot of questions about, did she take this from a family heirloom? Were these sorts of slips for sale? Why did she include this in her piece? It's hard to say. The bottom three are different from the top three in that they're all horizontally oriented, much more full of wax figures and many pieces, not really many pieces of shell. And they were all made by girls rather than women. We have the receipt of Sarah Morris learning how to make her shadow box. She was taught by a woman named Mary McAllister, who advertised for her school in Philadelphia. Mary McAllister was not a Quaker. And we know that Abigail Harrison worked on her box every morning before breakfast in her 16th year. So she was 15. And there's lots of questions going on here, clearly. But Sarah Morris, part of the Morris family, a very important early Quaker family in Philadelphia. She was the child of Anthony Morris, who was once the governor of Philadelphia. She makes a scene of Calypso's grotto from the Odyssey. And Abigail and Mary Morrison both show biblical scenes. Lots of questions arise out of these bottom three scenes. Were the wax figures made by the girls? Were they bought from professional artisans? Why were they making this in the first place? How does this have to, this sort of conspicuous consumption have to do with the fact that these women were supposedly living quite plain lives? There are scholars who have made it very clear that Quaker families, especially in Philadelphia, were living, you know, kind of decorative lives of the best sort, but plain. But these are entirely decorative, so opulent, they serve no purpose other than to be either hung on the wall or placed on a table. And they're just, they seem to be just exercises in leisure time, perhaps girls' education, and having access to a lot of money with which to buy all of these objects, these materials, these shells, and these pieces of wax. Speaking of buying these objects, I think that perhaps one connection between the production of these boxes and the materials that are used to make them is, again, global trade. And this is something I brought up in the last video. A lot of these girls who made these boxes were the daughters of important Philadelphia merchants. Perhaps these boxes were a way for these girls to present their family's mercantile success. They had access to objects from all over the world. They had access to wax figures likely made by professionals. They had access, and this is a whole other thing, to shells that were very much part of the slave trade. These shells, I've done a lot of research on them, and most of them come from the West Indies rather than the bodies of water in Pennsylvania and along the Delaware coast. These shells are indicative of a very active involvement by these Quakers in the West Indian slave trade. And what's also clear is that at least several of them owned slaves, even during the time when Anthony Benezet and John Woolman were advocating for Philadelphia Quakers to practice abolitionism. That is a whole can of worms. It's a very fraught issue. It's really fascinating. I read a lot about it in my PhD. I would be happy to talk to you about it in the comments. Let me know. Another final thing I want to talk about with these boxes and why they were made is perhaps these objects were devotional, that to sit in silence and to make these idealized scenes was a way for these women and girls to celebrate the world that God made, to not mimic it because they cannot mimic God, of course, but to celebrate and think about the glory of God, and to make this sort of God celebrating art form in silence. It's likely that they were making these by themselves rather than in a schoolroom, and that perhaps it was a form of silent worship. I realize that's kind of a crazy idea. but I think it's actually quite possible. It's, you know, producing this sort of object, you have to have a corporeal form very similar to worshiping, to reading the Bible, to bowing one's head and having one's hands out in front of oneself. And perhaps there is also a bodily connection between making these boxes and worship. So clearly, there's a lot to think about with these boxes. I did not even get into the issue that I brought up last time of an extremely plain lifestyle and an extremely unplain art form and what was happening with that contradiction. But yeah, these objects are really fascinating. When I show them to people, they would never expect them to be made by Quaker women, but they are all made by Quakers and by really leading members of Quakers, of Philadelphia's Quaker elite. These were leaders in their community. They were not some random so-and-sos. They were the daughters of extremely important men. So that itself is intriguing and mysterious. I hope you think it's mysterious as well. I'm working on answering a lot of these questions, but I think an important part of this is to bring up these questions in the first place. So I hope you enjoyed this video. Let me know if you want to know more about the shadow boxes. I would be happy to talk to you about them. Okay, bye.